Before the turn of the century. Makes me sound old. I was diagnosed with ALS. I don't know if you're familiar with ALS, but we're familiar with someone that maybe has suffered from Gehrig's disease. But it's a devastating disease. When I was diagnosed initially, that's what the doctor named Bailey and said that he had, that he would be watching him, put him in a special program. ALS affects your muscles and sort of makes the signal from your brain that goes through your nerves to your muscles not work right. And so eventually people who have ALS lose control of all of their voluntary muscles, legs and arms, etc. And it's very difficult to see. And it's usually an average lifespan of about 3 years. When I was diagnosed, the doctor said, 6 months is probably all you have to really keep preaching. And that you need to go ahead and get your affairs in order and make sure you have someone that's going to be able to take the pulpit, because it'll go pretty quickly. The speech was affected, and that usually is a sign of very fast progression. I wrote down what we wanted to say, and I'm going to be a spokesperson for parts of this, and they'll be part of it. When I did found out about ALS, I didn't see this. He tells me that he cried for about 3 hours straight. And, you don't think that you really are going to understand what's going on. And it doesn't all hit you at once. We were singing about the goodness of God. And I think God's goodness in part is he lets us experience and come to realization of things as we can handle them. When it hit him, of weeks, he cried and cried, and we were all gone out of the house. I was at work. One of the elders of the church called Ivan, and that kind of triggered the tears. But Ivan came to a realization that God wanted him to have a special approach to this, that he resolved in his heart to leave his family, leave us healthy physically and spiritually. How he approached the disease was going to make all the difference in the world on how it affected us. Daniel 1:8 resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and kept himself pure. And so this was Ivan's commitment to keep himself pure, not let this corrupt his attitude or his approach to life, but to stay pure before the Lord. For myself, I think I was in denial initially. And also, I had a lot of hope. God gave me enough hope to keep going along as we went. And I'm a planner. And so, in addition to that, I started thinking about all the things I needed to do. And God opened up the way for me to go back to school. I thought, well, I can either work two jobs now, or I can make more money. And so, it was the push I needed to go back and get my master's degree. And God took care of us. The other thing that was really interesting is that God, I feel that God told me you can pray one of two ways. You can pray that it go quickly for Ivan so that he doesn't suffer much, or that he's here for a long time. And so, but that means it's going to be harder on you. And I remember thinking that through and praying that God would keep him as long as possible. At the time, our boys were at the time, our kids were in 6th and 8th grade. Today, they're 26 and 28. So God has given Ivan many, many more years than that first doctor and clinic ever thought would be possible. We're very, very grateful for that. Also, telling our boys, you'd think that would be a difficult thing, and I guess it was, but Ivan, you can probably tell that he's a jokester and he loves to laugh, and so he just made it a funny thing all the time. So anytime as he was getting worse, anything that would, like his balance started to be affected and whatnot, well, our kids were just about at the right age, especially started progressing from walking with a cane to a walker to a wheelchair, and we decided that we were going to approach life with life. We don't want to focus on the disease. We wanted to focus on life that God had given us. We didn't want any of us to blame Ivan's condition for not getting good grades at school or not doing well at work or whatever the case may be, but to really focus on life and not focus on the condition. During this time, Ivan met someone called Mark Spears. Marty was a pastor at Bethany Bible Church. He was diagnosed with ALS about 2 years into Ivan's diagnosis.
And I used to go over and talk with him.
So he connected with Ivan, and Ivan used to go and talk with him at his house. Marty progressed very quickly within 18 months. So for us, it was a reality checking, first of all, of what we were facing and what could be, but also just a blessing to be involved in someone else's life. Marty and his wife, Pam, have 4 kids. Their youngest had just been born when he was diagnosed. And so it was very, very difficult. And we just saw Pam at the ALS Association's walk. She was there, but now her kids are grown, like early teenage to adulthood, and they're doing well. But it was during that time that Ivan started talking with Marty, and they asked the question that most people don't even think to ask unless you're faced with something difficult, and that is, what do we do to cause this to happen to us? And you know, these are two pastors. They knew better in their mind. God, it's not that you do something that causes things to happen to you, and that God can carry you through it. But it was a natural question that a lot of us ask when we go through something in the world. Did I do something wrong? What did I do to cause this? What is God punishing me for? And that's a difficult question because we've all done things. It doesn't matter how in our life has been, all of us have things that we could identify with and wonder what's going on. And through that, God, I didn't realize that God had a calling for him in what he was doing. That it wasn't part of his condition to just close down whatever ministry God had given to him. That God didn't need a healthy body to work through, but that God had a purpose for him, regardless of what was going on. What he needs is not a healthy body, but he needs is a living body. And in 2 Corinthians it says that he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness, so that Christ's power may rest on me. And that's why, for Christ's sake, I delight in my weaknesses and insults and hardships and persecutions and difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong." And that's because God has given us the ability to be his vessels. That's when God allows us, if we're willing, God allows us to just be that vessel that he uses and works through so that he can touch many people's lives. When we talk about God's goodness towards us, it's God's goodness that allows us to be able to experience that blessing even when we go through difficult times. There's some examples I wrote down here. Bethany Hamilton, she lost her arm to a shark. Nick Bolshevik, who's the man with no arms and no legs, goes around and preaches God's word and what God has done in his life. Fanny Crosby was blind and wrote over 8,000 hymns. God used her tremendously. So when an all life-altering experience happens to you, it's easy to look at your life as half empty. Pessimism can slip in there. And example, if I crawled up in my the corner of my mind to die, my family, my immediate family, my greater family, would have been affected even for generations to come. What we do or say has lasting consequences. The Lord is slow to anger, abounding in love, forgiving sin and rebellion, but he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children for the sin of the fathers, but to the third and fourth generation. What we do and say does affect people's lives. And what you're doing right now, what each of us is doing in our lives, affects the next generations to come as well. So what do you do if you have a life-altering experience? So I have a few pointers for you, and the first one is?
First of all, pray.
First of all, you want to pray.
Pray.
Then put down that this is a bad dream.
Pray is a bad dream.
Pray is a bad dream. Sometimes a lot of people will say, oh, God owes me. Why is this happening to me? I've done all this for God. Why is he letting this happen to me? But actually, God gives us stuff in, like Paul, he gave Paul the thorn in the flesh, because that's when we're weak. That's when actually God is able to make us strong.
God gave us everything.